Hello everyone. We will discuss about the error detection and recovery schemes in the compiler design in this lecture. See, whenever a programmer is writing a program, he's liable to make the mistakes. And the compiler design, whenever compiler design phases will identify those errors at the different phases and will report those errors to the programmer. So here we are going to study about various types of the errors which are possible that a programmer can make, and how do we identify those errors, and which of the phases of the compiler those errors will be identified, and how will those errors be reported, and we need to recover from those errors also. It means that if some error has been made in one of the sentence or one of the statement, and then we need to move ahead and need to find out the errors made in the other statements also. What compiler does that it takes the program as a whole and then tries to find out the errors from the entire program sentence by sentence and report all the errors at a time. Again, look at this diagram that in the compile time errors, there are three types of the errors possible. One is a lexical phase error, one is the syntactic phase error, which is identified in the syntax analysis phase of the compiler, and the semantic errors, which is identified at the semantic analysis. So let us start with the lexical phase errors. Lexical phase errors means when we are doing the lexical analysis, then we are able to identify some of the errors at that time only. The categories of these errors may be that exceeding length of identifier or the numeric constants. Let's say we have defined the range of, not the range actually, but the length of the identifier cannot be more than 80 characters. So if you are writing the 85 length character as an identifier, then it will not be accepted. So it will throw the error, which will be the lexical error. Okay. Similarly, for the numerical constants also, if you are writing the constant and the constant size is too large, then the defined range, defined limit, so it will throw the lexical error. Right? And the appearance of the illegal character, for example, here in the example one, what is said that you have written the printf statement, printf function, and then after it has got terminated with a semicolon, you have applied a dollar. So dollar is actually not the acceptable character, it's an illegal character. So it will throw this error. Fine. The unmatched string, for example, in the example 2, this is the comment statement. So in the comment statement, it should start with the a slash and the asterisk, and it should close with the asterisk and the slash. So here in this statement, you are not able to find out the starting set of a slash and the star or the asterisk. So this actually is the lexical error. Now, how do we recover from these type of the errors? So the recovery from the error is you have to remove one character at a time until you reach to the semicolon or the braces. So this is actually the panic. This is also called the panic mode recovery scheme. So it is actually very easy. This is the advantage. It is very easy to implement, and it guarantees that you will not go in the infinite loop. But the disadvantage is that a considerable amount of input is skipped, because if you have written, let's say, some of the valid characters also, so those valid characters will also get skipped. So this is the disadvantage. Now the syntactic phase errors. Actually, syntactic phase errors are very interesting. You must have studied the syntax analysis much in the detail than any other thing in the compiler design. You must have observed that whenever we are doing the parsing, we make the parsing table. So in those parsing table, not every entry is filled, especially for the LR parser. You must have seen that all the entries are not filled actually. Even in the LL1 parsing table also, you must have seen that not all the entries are filled. So if all the entries are not filled, then you actually need to check what are the entries which are not filled. So whenever any of those entries will be encountered while doing the parsing, you will say that is an error. So the typical syntax errors may be errors in the structure or missing operator. You are actually writing some statement, and in that statement an operator is expected and you have not written that operator. So this will be the syntax error. Misspelled keyword, for example, you had to write int and you write itn, or you had to write switch and you have wrongly written the switches. For example, here in the example, the spelling of the switch is swith, and here it is written switch. So that is actually not acceptable. So this actually is the syntax error. And the unlabeled parenthesis is also, you must have studied this unlabeled parenthesis somewhere in the data structure part while doing the questions on the SACs. Fine. So here also, if you have if you applied the parenthesis to write an expression and you have opened it and did not close it, or you closed it but you did not open it, fine. You have opened three parentheses and you have closed only two parentheses, or you have opened two parentheses and you have closed three parentheses. So all these are the syntax errors, or the errors which are identified at the syntactic phase or the syntax analysis phase. Now, how do you recover from all these errors? So recovering from all these errors are very easy, just as in the lexical phase error. There are actually in the syntax analysis phase, if you have the errors and you have to recover from those errors, so there are various schemes. So one of the schemes is the panic mode recovery that we have seen in the lexical analysis phase also, that you start deleting the characters until you reach a semicolon or a braces. Fine. So this is one of the schemes for the recovery. Another thing is that statement mode recovery. In this method, when a parser encounters an error, it performs necessary correction on remaining input. Okay, once, let's say the error has been found in one of the line or one of the statement, then it will move to the next statement. Okay, correction can be deletion of extra semicolons. For example, you applied more than one semicolon for the same statement, or at some place the comma was required and comma was required and you have applied a semicolon, or a semicolon was required and you applied a comma. Okay, or a semicolon was actually required and you have not applied that. So these are the modes for the recovery from these errors. While performing the correction, utmost care should be taken for not going into infinite loop. Obviously, you should not go into the infinite loop. There should be a limit to which you should apply this recovery scheme. Obviously, there will be some disadvantage with this scheme, is that it finds difficult to handle situations where actual errors has occurred before point of the detection. Okay, so this is the disadvantage. Now there is one more scheme by which you can recover from these errors, that you apply a grammar production which actually denotes the errors. Okay, so there are some of the errors which are very common that the user can make. So you have the production of you have the production for those errors. So if you have the production for those errors, then obviously when the if the user has made, it will be very easy for you to identify those errors and report to those errors. But it is very difficult to maintain such productions. It is about the global correction. The parser examines the whole program and tries to find out closest match for which the which is error free. For example, if I have written 100 line code, and in that 100 line code there are some errors I have made, so the parser will try to find out what is the closest match of that 100 line code which is error free. But it is very difficult because there will be many instances possible, and it is actually like you have, let's say you're writing some word, you're typing some word in the WhatsApp message, and in that WhatsApp message you have made a mistake in this, you made a spelling mistake. So to recover from those spelling mistake, it does it automatic correction. So it does the automatic correction because of two basic reasons, that it finds out what is the closest match, and the closest match is actually found by the minimum number of insertion, deletion and the modification operations. So that is also called the minimum edit distance. It's a dynamic programming problem, and the same is expected here also, that if you are writing if you have written a code, it will try to find out the correct code by deleting some of the lines or some of these characters, or by inserting some of the characters, or modifying some of the characters. Fine. So this is the scheme, but it is not actually practical. Now let us see the semantic errors, the errors which can be made at the semantic errors which can be identified at the semantic analysis phase. So there are some of the errors which are very much obvious. For example, let us take an example. It will be very easy to understand the semantic analysis. Let's take the first example. The first example says that there is an array A which has a size 10 and then a variable B. So B equals to A, meaning that the base address of array A, which is denoted as A, is being assigned to a simple variable B. So is it possible for a simple variable to hold an address? It is not. So it is a semantic error. Okay, it is a meaningless statement. Similarly, the example 2 says that we have a function, and in this function we have a statement return 10, and then thereafter we have a statement printf 10. So you see that the statement return should be the last statement in the function. If you have made the return statement, there is no meaning of the printf 10 statement. So it's a meaningless statement. If any statement is written after the return, it has no meaning. So these are the common mistakes that actually are made in the. Now see, there are many more semantic errors possible. For example, we have not declared a variable, or we have not declared an identifier and we are using that. Fine. So that is actually the semantic error. Or one of the error in which you have written any printf statement after the return that we have seen in the earlier example. Or the unmatched argument. For example, there is a function, we are calling a function, and while calling a function we are passing two arguments which are of integer type. And then while declaring those function, or while not declaring, actually while defining those function, we are giving it the type float and character. Fine. So this is actually mismatch character. For example, if we have written a function named as function, int a, int b. So this is the function declaration. After the declaration of the function, we call these functions, and we call this function with two different values. And then while writing its definition, we are starting with function, character x and float y. Now you see, you have declared all these arguments as integer while declaring, but while defining it, you are defining that these are of character and the float type. So this actually is a mismatch. So this also is the semantic failure. So there are various semantic phase errors are possible. And now, how to recover from this error if you have declared, if you've used an identifier and you have not used those identifiers? So this will be undeclared identifier. And to recover from this is like a symbol table entry for the corresponding identifier is made. Okay, the compiler itself does the entry to the symbol table. If the data types of two operands are incompatible, for example, we have seen the example of the function, then automatic type conversion is done by the compiler. So even though we have declared these two variables to have the integer type, but when we are defining the function, if that is of character type and the float type, so the value which is being passed to it will be converted to the character type and the float type automatically. So the type conversion can be done. Thank you.